And the audience, you will understand why we are so happy to have you, because this is some new information for some of us, even if you have been familiar in this field of fascia-oriented movement therapy, Pilates, yoga, fascial fitness, etc. This is new information, not only about mechanical loading, but also about nutrition. Welcome, Keys, in our...
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Robert. So it's wonderful. It's wonderful that you asked me to be here. It's great to be a part of this event that you're putting together. And as you said, what I'm going to be talking about is nutrition and loading to improve fascial function. And when we talk about loading in the musculoskeletal system, what we're talking about is we're talking about different types of load. And really, we can cut it down to three types of load that we really feel throughout the musculoskeletal system. The first one is the classic one. It's tension. When a contraction of the calf muscle here pulls on the Achilles tendon, we get this pull, and that's a tensional load. And that's going to be really important for giving the cells a certain signal. But if we instead look at a connective tissue within the knee, such as the meniscus, and the cartilage within the knee, now what we've got is we've got a compressive load as those loads push down on each other. And that's going to mean that the cells within this tissue are going to respond dramatically different to the cells within the Achilles tendon. And really what we find, or what's been found by a number of researchers over the years, is that all of the cells that make up these tissues, the meniscus or the retinacula, that allow shear forces of the tendons sliding along behind them, all of these cells came from the same origin. So they're all the same, essentially the same cell type, but they become very different in what they look like as adult cells simply because of the load that's placed upon them. When we compress them, what happens is the cells change their shape and they change the matrix that they make. When we put them under a tensile load or a stretching load, what we see is that they become a different shape, along the line of force, and they produce a lot of collagen and very small proteoglycans. When we compress them, they produce very big proteoglycans, which hold lots of water. And so, especially for people interested in fascia, the third type of loading, this sliding loading or this shear load, is really important, because what the fascia does is it facilitates the sliding of materials, of tissues within the body. So the musculoskeletal tissues can slide past each other because the cells that are on the top layer of those tissues are specifically designed in such a way as to produce proteins that allow them to maintain this function. So if we now take this big picture view of what we kind of think of clinically, and we look down right down at the cellular level, the cell within that tensile loaded Achilles tendon, look at how it's long and thin, and this length of the cell is actually aligned along the line of force. So when we pull in this direction, the cell becomes long in that direction. If we were to pull the same tissue in the opposite direction, the cell would change orientation and become elongated in that way. And when it does this, and when it senses this tensile load, it produces collagen 1, it produces lysyl oxidase, which is going to bind up the collagen 1 and make it stiffer. And it produces these small proteoglycans like decorin and biglycan, which are going to help form this collagen matrix, which is going to form our tendons or our tensile fascia. So the fascia that's always under a tensile load is going to have lots of collagen 1, it's going to be highly cross-linked, and it's going to have a lot of these small proteoglycans. Anything that's going to see compressive load, now look what happens to the cell. Instead of it being long and skinny, it's now short and round. And that's what we see in our cartilage. And when we see that, the cells change the shape, but it also changes the proteins it makes. And now instead of collagen 1, it makes collagen 2. And instead of small proteoglycans like decorin and biglycan, it produces these big proteoglycans like agrican, which holds lots and lots of water, and haluronin, and all of these really important molecules for holding water within the tissue. Because now what we've got is we've got a mesh of type 2 collagen holding this water enclosed proteoglycans. So as we compress it, there's lots of water there that resists the compression. And then the last one is this shear load. When we get this sliding load that we see as tendons go along retinacula, or as two muscles slide past each other, what we see is on the surface, we get this directional compression, essentially. And so we get a combination of the two, which is a directional loading, but it's a compressive load. So the cell is a little bit aligned along the line of shear, but it's still compressed, so it's going to be a little bit rounded. So it's going to produce these large proteoglycans, and it's going to produce collagen 1 near the top of this structure. But then the important protein that it also is going to produce is this protein lubricin, which, like aggrecan and all of these other proteoglycans, so protein and sugar, there are proteins that have these huge sugar molecules, and the sugar binds tons of water. And this, in the case of our fascia, this means that now we've got a lubricated surface. And when we have two lubricated surfaces, they move really smoothly past each other. And that's our normal function. So in order to get these things to happen, we need to produce these types of forces and these types of loads within these tissues so the cells know how to respond.